We'll begin our service by turning to our confession and forgiveness. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Gracious God, have mercy on us. We confess that we have turned from you and given ourselves into the power of sin. We are truly sorry and humbly repent. In your compassion, forgive us our sins, known and unknown, things we have done and things we have failed to do. Turn us again to you, and uphold us by your Spirit, so that we may live and serve you in newness of life through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. God, who is rich in mercy, loved us even when we were dead in sin and made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved. In the name of Jesus Christ, your sins are forgiven. Almighty God, strengthen you with power through the Holy Spirit, that Christ may live in your hearts through faith. Amen. We turn now to the reading. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Holy God, holy and mighty, holy and immortal, have mercy on us. Show us your mercy, O God, and grant us your salvation. Give us the joy of your saving help again, and sustain us with your bountiful Spirit. Give peace in all the world, for only in you can we live in safety. Keep the nations under your care. Guide us in the way of justice and truth. Let your way be known upon earth, your saving health among all nations. Let not the needy be forgotten, nor the hope of the poor be taken away. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and sustain me with your Holy Spirit. Lord, hear my prayer, and let my cry come before you. The Lord be with you.
Our first lesson today is from 1 Corinthians chapter 12, beginning with verse 27. Now you are the body of Christ and individually members of it. And God has appointed in the church first apostles, second prophets, third teachers, then deeds of power, then gifts of healing, forms of assistance, forms of leadership, various kinds of tongues. And are all apostles? Are all prophets? Are all teachers? Do all work miracles? Do all possess gifts of healing? Do all speak in tongues? Do all interpret? But strive for the greater gifts, and I will show you a still more excellent way. The Word of God, the Word of Life.
Thanks be to God.
The Holy Gospel is according to John. Glory to you, O Lord. John 1, verse 43 to 51. The next day, Jesus decided to go to Galilee. He found Philip and said to him, "Follow me." Now Philip was from Bethsaida, the city of Andrew and Peter. Philip found Nathanael and said to him, "We have found him about whom Moses in the law and also the prophets wrote, Jesus, son of Joseph from Nazareth." Nathanael said to him, "Can anything good come out of Nazareth?" Philip said to him, "Come and see." When Jesus saw Nathanael coming toward him, he said of him, "Here is truly an Israelite in whom there is no deceit." Nathanael asked him, "Where did you get to know me?" And Jesus answered, "I saw you under the fig tree before Philip called you." Nathanael replied, "Rabbi, you are the Son of God. You are the King of Israel." And Jesus answered, "Do you believe because I told you that I saw you under the fig tree? You will see greater things than these." And he said to him, "Very truly, I tell you, you will see heaven opened and the angels of God ascending and descending upon the Son of Man." The Gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
We will now pray together the prayer of the day. Almighty and everlasting God, you came to your apostle Bartholomew, grace truly to believe and courageously to preach your word. Grant that your church may proclaim the good news to the ends of the earth through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Ascribe to God alone.
Let us bow our hearts in prayer. Our gracious Heavenly Father, today we look at your faithful disciple, Bartholomew. We pray that you might teach us how to be bold witnesses, like him in his life. Teach us how we might go about our daily lives in quiet, as well as in joyfully making noise for you with faith in Christ. Bless our hearing of your word this day. Amen. On this day, we celebrate and commemorate the life of Bartholomew, who was one of the 12 disciples of Jesus. Nathanael apparently was from the town of Cana, the site of Jesus' first miracle. He was invited to discipleship, according to our lesson today, by Philip, who told him that he and Andrew had found the Messiah in the person of Jesus of Nazareth. At first, Bartholomew, or Nathanael, was doubtful, but after a word from Jesus, he followed. You might be wondering about our text, because there's nothing about our friend Bart at all. It's all about Jesus calling Nathanael. So here is where it gets a little bit confusing. Each of the gospel writers enumerate 12 disciples in a list that they provide for us after Jesus has finished calling all of them. Matthew, Mark, and Luke each name the 12 disciples, putting their names in pairs. Bartholomew is always listed with Philip. Now, John's list does not follow the same pattern as Matthew, Mark, and Luke. In fact, in John, instead of Bartholomew, he puts Nathanael in that list of 12 disciples. And in the story that we have today, he pairs Nathanael with Philip, so by deduction, we assume that Nathanael was Bartholomew, which in the language of today literally means son of Tholomai. I guess I could have two names too. One could be Daniel, one could be son of John, which is my father. Now, not every scholar agrees with those deductions, but for the sake of our remembrance today, we will agree with it. With almost nothing, except for this story of his call to discipleship to go on, we have to depend on the tradition to fill in the details about Bartholomew's later life. Depending on what stories a person wants to believe, he could have preached in India or in Ethiopia, in the countries around the modern-day Iraq, or on the coast of North Africa and Egypt. The stories of his death also agree only in that he was martyred. Some say that he was martyred by flaying. Others say by decapitation. Flaying, by the way, is the removal of one's skin with a knife, a very torturous kind of a way to die. And like a number of other saints, there are two conflicting stories about where he was buried. Two different Christian groups in two different countries claim that he was martyred in their land and perhaps buried there as well. About the only thing that we can say with certainty about Bartholomew is that he is a faithful follower of Jesus Christ. He was there as Jesus preached his kingdom. He was there at the last meal. He was there to greet the risen Christ in the upper room. Unlike Peter, though, he was not heralded as a leader, but as a follower. In honoring Bartholomew, we honor also today all Christians who may think of themselves as the least important and the least significant in the Lord's army. Never did he stand out like Peter or James or John. And so if you sometimes regard yourselves as hardly counting, as little more than a name on a membership list, as only a face in the congregation, then we want to honor you today in the name of Bartholomew. If you think that the congregation would not miss you if you didn't show up and would hardly remember you after you're gone, then let us honor you today alongside of Bartholomew as an unsung follower of Jesus. The late Dr. Elvin Rognes told a story of a college entrance form which was to be filled out by the parents of prospective students. One father contemplated the question that read, "Would you say that your son or daughter is a leader or a follower?" The temptation, of course, was to answer, "Leader, of course." But he had to be honest. And so he wrote, "My son is a good boy. He is constant, dependable, he gets things done, but you could hardly call him a leader. So that's why I will mark follower." An official of the college was so impressed with the father's answer that he took the time to write to the father. And he wrote, "It gives me great comfort to know that in this fall's freshman class of several hundred leaders, we can count on one follower." Now let's let Bartholomew, the most excellent follower of Jesus, remind us that one does not need to be in great leadership positions in order to be a bold witness. "In my years of ministry, I have known many great witnesses to their faith. Some of them were duly recognized, but always there were some who deferred the attention that they deserved to the one who was greater, to Christ. My father was usually a very quiet man. Unless there was something, of course, that really got under his skin, then he could make a lot of noise. One of those buttons that pushed my father to action was the poor conditions that were experienced by the mentally and physically handicapped people in Japan. He decided that something needed to be done. This quiet man of faith started to make a lot of noise for these people, and it made a significant difference in how these people are treated in Japan today. You might say that my father believed that Christianity is not an outline of doctrine, nor is it a system of worship. Christ gave us more than a teaching or a doctrine. He gave us his own life. Like Bartholomew, we are invited to walk along this road to the kingdom of God, the road of following Jesus by taking up his cross. The Japanese Imperial Highness, Prince Mikasa, the son of the famous Emperor Hirohito, is very much interested in the Old Testament in his life. During one of the meetings of the Old Testament Society, he explained why he had such interest. During the Second World War, he went to Manchuria as a commander-in-chief of the Japanese army. There he met a missionary from the United States. And since the war had already become violent, most of the missionaries had already left and returned
to their homelands. But this woman remained in a village in the mountains, taking care of the poor children there. Prince Mikasa was deeply impressed by this woman's sacrificial way of life. Her way of life made him want to understand Christianity. And so when he returned to Japan, he began to study the Bible at the Tokyo University. And years later, his brother, Prince Hitachi no Miya, who would later descend the imperial steps at a convention hall after announcing the names of about 200 recipients of one of Japan's highest awards for service to humanity. He would pause in front of another foreign missionary who gave his life to serve his people, and he would say to him, "Thank you for your service to our people." My father was one of the only foreigners that would receive this award, and the only one that would be acknowledged in person by Prince Hitachi no Miya as he exited that hall. As I said, Christianity is more than a teaching, it is more than a doctrine, it is a way of life. And we make witness to our faith by the way we live. Today we remember also our own histories of our churches. We have been around for almost 150 years. We're not quite there yet. And how many faithful saints can we think of who in powerful ways, as well as in silent ways, brought the bold witness of Christ, like Bartholomew? How many of our saints of old, who were faithful janitors, who were faithful Sunday school teachers, who were faithful congregational presidents and congregational quilt makers, can we think of who would give their lives in service to others? They would be the ones who would follow in Bartholomew's train. We certainly do give thanks to God for the faithful pastors who have provided leadership over the years. We thank God for their witness, their testimony, their preaching, and their guidance. But chiefly we give thanks for the many Bartholomews who have heard the call of Christ and who have followed quietly and faithfully, handing down the faith to their children and to their grandchildren. We are thankful for all of their lives, for they served as quiet witnesses to the amazing things that God is doing in our midst. And because of all of these saints, and because of you who are our saints living and serving with God as your focus in life today, because of them and their courage and your courage, because of the gospel they and you pass down, we gather together today as a forgiven people, a people of God who live in hope and joy. We are ready to come and see in answer to our Lord's call. We are ready to joyfully and boldly follow Jesus into the new preferred future that God is planning for us. Let us rejoice and say thanks be to God for the call that He has given us. Let all of God's people say, Amen. Amen.
I will come to you in the silence. I will lift you from all your fears. be still and know I am here.
Let us confess our faith together using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Let us pray for the whole people of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. O Lord Jesus, you called to yourself Bartholomew, a person whom you said was without deceit, and he saw in this invitation a sign that you were the Son of God and King of Israel. In the same way, call us, O Lord, with your invitation to come and see. Give to us the same faith to call a thing what it is, and to be honest in our own words, especially in our words about our faith. God of mercy, hear our prayer. Lord Jesus, you are active in our world today. Give us eyes to see in faith your divine hand in the events of daily life, and the discernment to know your will, and the grace to live in obedience to your will. God of mercy, hear our prayer. Come and hear our prayers, O Lord, for our leaders who are governing in trying times. Enable them to rule in ways that bring safety to all. Grant them grace and wisdom to use the meager resources that are available to help as many people as possible. God of mercy, hear our prayer. Rest your joy upon Kayla and Jake, who were married yesterday. Grant to them a lifetime of opportunities to serve in your name. God of mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, we pray for all who are struggling with the COVID virus. We pray for those who are in need of medical care but are holding back because of fear. We pray for all who are yearning for healing and strength. We pray especially, O Lord, for Jerry Ashburn, for Jody Iverson, and for others whom we name in our hearts before you today. God of mercy, hear our prayer. Encourage your children, the members of the Southeastern Diocese of the Lutheran Church in South Africa, as they elect their bishop and many deacons tomorrow. Bring unity as you call them to new mission endeavors. God of mercy, hear our prayer. We give you thanks, O God, for the saints who have deepened our lives of prayer, especially Saint Bartholomew, whom we remember today. Gather us with them in endless praise of you. God of mercy, hear our prayer. We have seen your gracious hand at work in our midst. We have come into your presence believing that you will hear our prayers. We commend all for whom we pray into your hands. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
I am so dead.
gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us.
Our Father in heaven,
hallowed be your name.
Your kingdom come,
your will be done,
on earth as in heaven.
Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Go forth into the world to serve God with gladness. Be of good courage. Hold fast to that which is good. Render to no one evil for evil. Strengthen the faint-hearted, support the weak, help the afflicted, and honor all people. Love and serve God, rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let us bless the Lord. Thanks be to God. The Almighty God bless us, defend us from all evil, and bring us to everlasting life. Amen. Peace. Serve the Lord. Thanks be to God.